Hello and welcome back on Primetime Watchmaking in the News, and it seems like already a super long time since the last edition published in early July. So happy to be back with this program, and we have plenty of news to share because even though the watchmaking world goes slightly into hibernation during this summer, yes, I know this kind of antinomic concept, well, nevertheless, there has been quite a few watchmaking related stuff going on in the past weeks, mainly business shenanigans and some other considerations, and not too much on the product launch side of things. That's normal and part of the season, but it will accelerate within the next weeks or so, and we already have a few hints of exciting timepieces that will soon be launched that I mentioned at the end of this video. But let's start with a bit of a very quick auto-congratulation, because we are celebrating our 6th year anniversary on the 1st of September. Crazy how time flies, and after more than 1,000 video reports produced, well, we still have plenty of things to tell. So thank you so much for watching, sharing, commenting, subscribing, liking. This has become a fabulous and inspiring community. You can't imagine how happy it makes me feel and how it energizes me and my small team. And a very special mention to all of you that have pledged a buck or two to help us finance this watchmaking adventure through our Patreon campaign. Sincerely, I am very moved by this, and just wanted to say that you can count on us to keep pushing further with what we do, as there is this special project I'm working on, which is, I promise you, very unbelievably cool. Okay, I'm not very objective about that, and I can't really talk about it yet, but I promise that is something really quite fantastic and quite big to put in place, and needs naturally quite a bit of resources too. So okay, enough teasing, and let's go back to Primetime, because there are apparently some pretty good news for the industry, as it seems that the Swiss export figures have been slightly going back up. But I would personally take this with extreme caution, because as we know, that the global environment for watch brands is a rather shaky one for a multitude of reasons, and I won't repeat myself regarding this. But I just sincerely hope that things will indeed go in the right direction for everybody, meaning us, the consumers, and of course all the many people working in the industry. But when I read the other day that someone was saying that they just couldn't cope with demand, well, I was naturally a bit dubious, if you see what I mean. But if it's the case, well, really cool for them, and I can naturally only wish them that. Anyhow, it's true that some markets have been doing good, and this leads me to the second point of this Primetime. Since the Brexit and the significant weakening of the British currency, well, this had had a big impact on the prices of watches sold in Great Britain for tourists and for some UK people that had some stronger currencies available. So over the last 12 months or so, brands were very happy of selling all their stock already in the UK prior to the Brexit, and because of the general downturn of the industry, well, brands were too unhappy to replenish these stocks and keep those competitive prices. But now the party seems to be a bit over, as the price difference makes it clearly uneven between a shopping destination, and we've recently heard of brands hiking up their prices in the UK to adjust to international levels. We've heard, for instance, that Patek Philippe adjusted their price by roughly 5-6% on their collection, but this doesn't stop Great Britain and London in particular of being a very sexy shopping destination for many people. And to face with this high demand, we've heard, for instance, that Harrods, the legendary Knightsbridge Emporium, will double the surface made available for high-end watch brands. And when you think that this was almost a non-existing business for them just a few years ago, well, it just shows how important this has become for them, and how vice versa, Harrods is important for the brand, since most of these brands have their own boutique not too far away from Harrods. But the drive such an institution can pool is just phenomenal. But talking about institution, and still in the UK, well, this is a sound you will not hear any longer, or at least not for the next 4 years. Well, yes, the famous Westminster chime that some minute repeater timepieces mimic in what is considered as the grail of complication, well, Big Ben has just been put on silence as it will go over some serious restoration work. I mean, this clock has been chiming for approximately 150 years, and it is time for this venerable landmark in watchmaking culture to be overhauled and restored, and this process will indeed take 4 years, so quite some serious work apparently to be done. And since it's a very important touristic attraction, well, we've heard quite a lot of people in Britain complaining about the length of the process. I have to admit that I would really love being able to do some kind of hands-up, follow-up on this immense task. That would make for some pretty interesting video reports, I'm quite sure, not exactly the same size as the timepieces we're accustomed to cover on the Watchers TV, but still would be pretty cool. So if any Big Ben people are listening, please consider us for this. So going back to business, and despite what I've said previously on some recovering signs, well, we just heard a pretty sad news as Manufacture Contemporaine du Temps just announced that they would temporarily stop their operation. Temporarily means like, okay, it's over. But anyhow, MCT and Denis Giguet, that's the creative and talented watchmaker behind this brand, well, they had introduced some pretty cool watches over the past few years. We never really covered them, unfortunately. But one of the originality of this brand, small independent brand, was their mechanical time display with jumping hours, moving panes, and retrograde hands. Of course, this was a very niche brand, rather confidential. Watches were not cheap, of course. But it just shows how difficult it is for these small independent brands to find their economical sustainability. And we just hope that the list won't get any longer, because you guys know how important these small brands are in bringing and keeping some kind of freshness and hype on the watchmaking table. Still in the business news and following the massive major announcements of the summer with the head of the Richemont Group heading to take over Breitling, well, this has definitely shaken quite a few things or two. As a quick reminder, Mr. Georges Kern kind of shared his responsibilities with Mr. Jérôme Lambert, the former heading watches development and communication, the latter being in charge of operation. And though this news dates already for since already a few weeks ago, well, we still don't know who will replace Mr. Georges Kern. By the way, and if you haven't seen it, I clearly invite you to check the special report we did on this announcement and what it hides. A report entitled The Season Finale of the House of Cards of Watchmaking. And the good news is that the new season is about to begin with some new plots and other intrigues. So coming back on Richemont and its spectacular portfolio of super high-end brands, well, they are currently in a strange situation, and from the outside, it looks like they don't really know where they are heading. I know it may sound a bit harsh to say it like this, but most of the brands have taken what I believe are questionable directions, and this is reflected with some of them struggling in terms of business. So, I mean, they need to reinvent themselves in a certain way, or to be more precise, I mean, they need to redefine who they are, go back to the origin, what is their core legitimacy, and stick to it instead of all trying to become lifestyle brands. And I'm not saying this with a passéist or nostalgic mindset. Things have changed and you need to evolve and adapt. I concur, no problem about that. But anyhow, quite a tough challenge ahead of them, and therefore the recruitment of the group's new CEO is a very strategic and determining choice. We don't know if they will look for a profile within the group. Sounds a bit complicated because of all the politics there. But then, are there that many outside players suited for the role? Not that many. Well, cards are on the table, and this hotspot in the Richemont food chain will be a complicated position to fulfill. I can't wait to know more, and count on us for some follow-up on this intriguing and development and the consequences it will provoke. And this is just the perfect transition to talk about another interesting move in the industry, as Ulysse Nardin have just announced the nomination of a new CEO with the arrival of Mr. Patrick Pruniot, and his track record is a very interesting one. Before coming back on this, let me quickly tell you my thoughts about Ulysse Nardin, because though it's a brand that I think is quite remarkable when it comes to innovation and the technical dimension of their business, well, for the rest, well, you see how confused I am. Okay, so Ulysse Nardin is an old brand dating from 1846 with a strong watchmaking legitimacy. They were highly recognized for the precision of their timepieces and produced, for instance, marine chronometers used by many, many navies around the world during the 19th century. Well, then the brand kind of slowly died off before it was taken over in the early 80s by Rolf Schneider and some other investors, and gave the brilliant watchmaker Ludwig Oechslin the means to redevelop the brand with some watchmaking credibility and serious innovation. To pinpoint an example, Ulysse Nardin was among the pioneers that explored the properties of silicon for regulating organ of watches, and Mr. Oexlin was a master regarding astronomical developments too. Anyhow, Mr. Holzschneider was a brilliant businessman, and he managed to establish the brand as a key player in different markets, and bravo to him. But where I want to get at is that despite having continued to develop very interesting products, well, pretty well positioned too when you consider the technical expertise and other craftsmanship found on some of its more pieces and models, well, I think that it's quite difficult to say what Ulysse Nardin is as a brand. The notion of coherence is an open question, and it feels like they didn't really leave the 1980s in terms of design, okay? And this can be said also about their communication and so forth. So anyhow, it's nevertheless a very interesting brand, and it deserves actually a full who's who of watchmaking episode on them. And so the brand was bought by the Kering Group for a small fortune just days before Ulysse Nardin's business faced a really serious backlash, mainly because of all that was going on with Russia, which was a super key market for them. So bad luck for Kering, but that's not the reason why they can't rebound with all this know-how and intellectual property. And the arrival of Mr. Pruneau as CEO again is an interesting move, because Mr. Pruneau has been working in the LVMH empire, a luxury empire, and actually spent 9 years at Tag Heuer taking care of commercial distribution, among other responsibilities. But then that's when it gets very interesting, because he got headhunted by Apple to oversee the launch of the Apple Watch a few years ago. So having a clear watchmaking culture, knowing how sales and distribution work, knowing how big groups work, plus this pretty exceptional Silicon Valley experience on a product representing a big threat for the industry, well, those are all very great assets for what remains a very, very big challenge. But I sincerely think that it's a good move for Ulysse Nardin, and I'm really looking forward to see how things will play for them, even though it will probably take a bit of time, but let's keep positive about it. So let's now change subject and follow one of the reports we previously published on the pertinence of brand ambassadors. Well, I had done this one following the announcement of David Beckham becoming the Tudor ambassador. And just for a little side and funny story, he was seen at Wimbledon wearing a Rolex watch instead of his Tudor. Okay, so same company more or less, but when you're probably paid gazillion millions of dollars as an ambassador, and the deal still being quite fresh, and as a public figure, you do know that in your home country, cameras would be on you during one of the most prestigious tennis event on the planet. Well, anyhow, it just unfortunately demonstrate quite well this notion of questionable loyalty, but okay, apparently, who cares? Well, after this great feat, well, we just heard that now Tudor have made Lady Gaga an ambassador. So I guess that watchmaking marketing is mainly about immediate visibility and awareness. But here at the Watches TV, we will continue to focus on the timepieces and the crafts behind them. We're kind of stupid old school approach, but that's okay, I can live with that. And another great and crazy example of this marketing frenzy is with this outrageous and staged money fight we saw the other day between boxer Floyd Mayweather and UFC fighter Conor McGregor. So no real sporting interest. It's as if you organize a race between a sprinter Usain Bolt and a middle distance runner Mo Farah. They are both great champions, okay? They both run, but they don't simply do the same thing. And for this fight, it was kind of the same awkward situation. And when you saw the money involved in such an event, well, it's just totally insane. And my point is that to see the Hublot brand name stitched on Floyd Mayweather's short, well, you know, we're talking serious money to do something like that. Apparently $1 million. Corona Beer paid $10 million to have its name on the ring. So with such level of money, you know that everyone wants some kind of return. And therefore, I was not too surprised that the fight lasted that long. Everyone wants airtime, and the longer, the better. Because I'm quite convinced Floyd Mayweather could have won much faster. Okay, I'm not this kind of conspiracy theory type of guy, and I ain't a boxing expert either. But nevertheless, this probably arranged everyone. And you know what? it works, or at least I thought it did. Look at Hublot's YouTube channel. With the marketing power this brand has and the number of videos they produce, well, the reality is that most of their videos have like 500 views, and I'm not talking 500k views. No, I really mean 500 views. So quite a shocker, right? But when they did a video with Floyd Mayweather training prior to the fight, I got this YouTube message telling me about it. And then I saw that they got almost 1 million views with it. So okay, not bad, I said to myself. But then when you actually see that with 1 million views, there are 44 likes and 11 comments, well, you know that there is something fishy. What can I say? Well, nothing, I guess. And the rules of marketing will always be quite obscure for me. But the good news is that we here on this channel, and thanks to you, we really do a minimum of 500,000 views per month with real people looking, enjoying, and we have this cool exchange between us. We share and we love to share, and it's all about experience. And talking about experience and sharing, well, I had mentioned in the previous edition of Primetime that Patek Philippe had put this this special exhibition in New York, and I was very happy to learn the other day that a bit more than 27,000 people visited it and therefore had some kind of watchmaking experience. And they were not all diehard Patek Philippe fans or neither watchmaking fans, but people wanting to see a bit more up close what it was all about. See the craftsmen present, the special watches put on display. So that's really cool to hear that they managed to have this turnout. And yes, it's Patek, yes, it's a special brand, kind of in a league of its own. But nevertheless, a cool success for them. And talking exhibition and what to expect in September, well, if you are in Hong Kong between the 5th and the 9th of September, there is the Hong Kong Watch and Clock Fair going on. Okay, it's not really the SIJH, but I guess it must still be quite interesting if you are in the vicinity. And continuing with the upcoming stuff, well, I am very excited to say that A. Lange & Söhne have invited me in mid-September to attend a very special launch event where they will unveil something apparently simply extraordinary, some kind of new masterpiece. Well, we'll see, but count on me to bring to you a very cool story. And still talking new things, Zenith will also be unveiling something quite revolutionary. We had a little sneak peek at it when it was on Jean-Claude Beaver's wrist and showed it to you a couple of months ago. But this time is the real thing, can't wait either. And one last thing, well, I was really happily surprised to see the massive success of our video on optical solutions seen at the APHG Trade Fair pool. Well, this Hyrox solution is really something quite special, and it's naturally giving me a few ideas in terms of filming, reading up close some of the watches to show you what true hand finishing is all about, for instance, or some serious watch porn there with such a cool tool. So if you haven't seen this video, well, link also below in the description. So this was it for Primetime. Thanks for your time. Thanks for commenting and sharing. All the super best to you, and see you real soon.